You're still watching the Pulse on the Joy News channel on Malta TV. And just before we brought you that story in politics, there's some updates we can bring you now. The first story we brought you about the job database system is beginning to draw some reactions already from the Ghana Unemployed Graduates Association. The president, Desmond Baini, is joining us now on the line. Thank you, Mr. Baini, for joining us. Government says through the Youth Employment Agency, they are introducing a jobs database system which will allow or even help us get to understand who are the ones unemployed and how they can help for placement. What do you make of this system, first of all?
Thank you very much, my brother. Let me make this clear. The issue about collecting data of employment on of people employed and those unemployed has been in existence since 2003. But it's just that we haven't had anyone to take that bold initiative. It is the mandate of the Labor Department to collect data of every Ghanaian who is either employed or unemployed. When you look at part two of the Labor Act, Act 651-2003, you will realize that it has stated clearly that there should be a public agency that collects data. And it was very clear on sections 4 and 6, which states that there would be an agency, a center to collect data, register all unemployed persons. So, to be very honest with you, you would commend the Youth Employment Agency for doing that job, but it is not their mandate to do that. The mandated institution by law to do that is the Labor Department. But what is the case at the Labor Department? The last time I was there, I spoke with the Chief Labor Officer. You would realize that they are very, very under-resourced, and therefore they are not able to execute their mandate to the fullest. Therefore, this thing, they are not able to collect the data that we wish that they would collect for us. Then again, too, if the Youth Employment Agency says mm-hmm. that it will take up that mandate, although it's a good initiative, I'm not being a prophet of doom, but I can say that they can't execute that task to the fullest because it must be district-based, that every district must have a center that collects data of its unemployed person and unemployed person, and then they can forward it to the national data. But the question we should ask ourselves is the Youth Employment Agency resource enough to do that? I think there has been a great failure on the part of the Ministry of Employment and Labor Relations, which is supposed to see to it that this thing is done. And it is rather unfortunate that Mr. Honorable Harry Naidrisu have not taken any steps to do that.
Mr. Baini, you said that they've not done enough to handle this, but if what we are learning of today is anything to go by, they've started that process, haven't they? As we speak, they speak of some 600,000 that they've been able to capture
and
in the database.
It's not the responsibility of Youth Employment Agency to do it. It's the responsibility of the Labor Department to do it. And therefore, the Youth Employment Agency can do a half-baked job and tell you that, yes, it was not our mandate. We decided we tried doing something, but we couldn't finish. But should all resources be pushed to the Labor Department, who are mandated by law to do it, then you can hold them accountable that at this point, we gave you these resources for this job, and you were unable to do it. That is the case. That's the point we are stressing on here. That it's unfortunate. When you look at the Youth Employment Agency and the Labor Department, they all fall under the Ministry of Employment and Labor Relations. Why should the minister sit there and allow this conflict of interest to conflict of work to go on there? I think that most of the times, most of the difficult situation we find ourselves in this country is setting up parallel institutions. When you set up parallel institutions, you end up hitting institutions by their head. And it would, at the end of the day, go a long way destroying things which must be done right. A simple example is having Yoko and having Shraj, who, by law, that's almost the same thing, similar things. For instance, someone corrupt, someone is corrupt. That person is taken to Yoko. Yoko comes up with their report. The same person is taken to Shiraz. Shiraz comes up with their report. Should the report conflict? What do we see? That same thing is happening. That same situation is what we find ourselves when law says that labor departments must do this job, and we are saying that youth employment agencies should do it. At the end of the day, youth employment agencies are not going to do it at a free cost. They are going to do it at a cost.
Okay.
And also, I have a great observation about them, Mr. Amu, when he spoke, the man from Ministry of Employment and Youth Employment Agency, he stated clearly that if they registered 600,000 people, that number to us is in doubt because we have our checks from the Youth Employment Agency. We don't trust that number that they've registered 600,000.
So, pay our checks, what do you know they have registered?
The number is not even up to 300,000, sir.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Mr. Baini. You've clearly raised some concerns about what needs to be done in tackling the issue of unemployment, especially with the database a bit more. Thank you for your thoughts. I'm sure that it will also have to, help in us getting things right, especially when it comes to the thorny matter of jobs and unemployment. Now, just before we check out how things are heating up on the campaign trail, let's bring you the peace message for today. In his peace message for today, the moderator of the Methodist Church of Ghana, in fact, the presiding bishop of the Methodist Church of Ghana, Right Reverend Titus Awoche Pratt, is asking every stakeholder in this election to work for peace because, honestly, it's not automatic.
We cry for peace. Heaven, peace. Lord, we cry for love.
So peace is not automatic. You work for peace and you maintain peace. There are other ingredients that go into making peace stable. The first is justice. People in the community should recognize each other as equal partners in the community. And when that happens, you will respect the differences that we see among persons who live together. Secondly, you will regard those differences as enough to as catalyst to make you a better person, because you weigh others with yours and you adopt or adapt to others, and that makes you a richer person. You're able to move around and associate people. And so peace is one thing that is not automatic, but that peace is worked for and maintained with justice, equanimity, understanding, regard for authority, recognition of different persons in the community. When these come together, we're able to live in peace. The EC is supposed to be independent electoral commission. And so that is what they are supposed to do. They have been battered here and there by different opinions and persons, but if they remain focused on what the law is expects of them, they will be able to function well for all of us. Secondly, all stakeholders, different political parties with different agendas and whatever they call themselves, as well as security agents that are in the country, are all not to be partial in such a way that others may be disadvantaged. The police services, the military, whatever, all the security agencies are to work for the peace of the entire nation. They should not be seen to be leaning towards A against B or D against E. These will create problems for us. So all bodies in the country, security agents, political parties, civil society, all should know the agenda they are following and to follow the agenda to the letter in such a way that what we expect as a result of the impending elections will be achieved. What is it? That a party or a government will come into power to manage the affairs of the nation, to which all of us will accept. And so every person or every group in this country should work towards making this election peaceful, and afterwards also a stable country for ourselves. I would require all Christians in this country to be above reproach. Christians are to exercise their franchise by going to vote. Vote and return home. Don't be part of any group of persons who aim at causing chaos or disturbances. No. I speak also for all religious bodies, Christian, Muslim, whatever. Let us show the world that indeed we are worshiping a God who is peaceful and loving, a God who is considerate, and he's made the world so different in such a way that when all these events come together, we see the richness which is in God. So let us all together pray for a peaceful period before the elections, during the elections, and a stable country for ourselves after the elections.
And after the peace message, I'm sure we can check out what's happening today on the campaign trail, and helping us to go through what kind of activities are happening on that trail is Jennifer Kerma. She's been busy monitoring that space for us. Jennifer, good afternoon to you.
Afternoon, Francis.
I know 21 days to go. A lot of things are happening with the campaigns.
Mm.
All the presidential candidates are busy on the ground trying to sell their message. But how are things looking like today, per your monitoring?
Well, it's been a very busy day for all the presidential aspirants. Even those who were failed, you know, in their bids to make it to the presidential ballot paper, they've also been rather busy. I'll tell you all about that shortly. Starting from the northern regions, I call it the Northern Trinity, because this week, at least starting from over the weekend, it's been very busy with political activity.
Okay.
The president right now is in the Upper West region. It's the first time he's been there since the campaign, since his manifesto was launched, actually. And he's slated to visit all 11 constituencies in that region.
Okay.
And right now, he's been speaking to the chiefs and people of Dorimo, where he has promised that if they vote for him, if they support him, he will not let them down.
Okay.
Now, it's also been a day of quite a lot of fanfare for the people of Upper West, because, you know, the president is, you know, he's to fly in on their, you know, and arrive at their new airport in Uwa. So it's been quite a busy day for NDC party.
Okay. And once you've touched on the Upper West region, let's speak to Rafiq Salam, our man covering the president in that region as we speak. Rafiq, good afternoon to you. Been a busy day, I know, but where is the president now? What's happening? Fill us in.
Hello?
Rafi, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
Great. So I know you've been busy covering the president. Where is he now? What's happening?
Currently, we are about reaching Wachau, which is on the Wild West constituency. Earlier, the president visited Dorimo, where he met the paramount chief and his divisional chief, and also members of the NDC party in that particular area. But after that, he went to Jambuso, which is closer to Burkina Faso, where the water project is being, where they are doing the water project. And the project cost about 51.5 million. So the president went there on an inspection tour and see the progress of work. And work at that particular place is almost completed. And now the president is about entering Wachau to speak to chiefs and people of that particular area.
Okay, Rafiq. So we know that he is scheduled to get to the 11 constituencies on a 3-day tour of the region.
Can you come again?
We know that he's looking to visit the 11 constituencies in the region as part of his tour. What is his itinerary? What's the plan for the NDC in the Upper West region as we head into this election?
What is the plan for
the NDC in the Upper West region, their target?
I'm talking about the project. After which he's expected to move to the White East, where he's going to hold rallies there, and also that the Vimo Bute is district. But the other commission that we are told is likely to happen at Lamusi on Saturday, where the president is expected to commission the E-block in that particular constituency. And so that's what is on the agenda of the president. But he's been going around and he's been telling the people that they need to return him, because he thinks that he's one of their own. And so based on the good record he has done, they should retain him to continue his good work.
All right. Thank you, Rafiq Salam, for that update. So clearly, the president is busy. After last night's evening encounter on the state broadcaster, he's already gone back into the campaign business, busily trying to galvanize as many votes as he can as we're looking ahead to the elections. Jennifer is still with me. Jennifer, that's for the president in the Upper West region. Mm-hmm. How about his opposite number, the MPP's presidential candidate, Nana Akufo-Addo? Where is he now?
Well, he's in, you can literally say, on the opposite side of the country. He's in the eastern region. But before we go to Nana Akufo-Addo and his activities there in his home region, let's take a quick look at what the president was talking about on the presidential conversation on GTV last night.
Okay.
My issue with you, Mr. President, is we have all these wonderful laws lined or rolled out for persons with disability. When are we going to see the full implementation of these laws? For example, we have the National Council for Persons with Disability, yet it is not at the regional or district level.
Thank you very much. I just want to say that estimates are that nearly 10% of our population suffer from one disability or the other. And so it means that over 2 million of our compatriots have a disability or other. And that is why issues of disability must be taken very seriously. And under this government, we have tried within the constraints that we have for persons with disability as possible. There have been, like he said, there have been treaties that have been pending. We have sent all of them for ratification. And I wish to inform the questioner that the Marrakesh Treaty has been ratified. I personally made sure that it was ratified. It has to do with ensuring that persons who are visually impaired have enough material of public documents so that they also know what is happening in the country. I've made sure of that, and so we've ratified it. Aside from that, we have worked to try and include all our compatriots with disability in living a normal life, in being able to go to school. And that is why we've done the inclusive education policy, so that they're able to go to school normally like everybody else. There are many homes and rural communities where children with disability are hidden. And so you find that it's time to go to school and they don't appear, because they are kept at home and they believe that because they are disabled, they don't go to school. And so we're trying to get them to change that. And that's why I have moved the function of social welfare, which includes disability, to the Minister of Gender, Children and Social Protection, because that ministry, I believe, can specialize and focus more on disability issues than employment and social welfare. Employment has to deal with industrial disputes and things, and so often issues of people with disability gets buried under all the more urgent GBC red bands and things, you know. And so getting a more caring ministry was one of the first actions I took. And so I believe that where I've positioned it, it will get more attention. Aside from that, we've increased the share of the common fund that is going to persons with disability under the DACF. In the last budget, I increased it by another 30%, so that that share of money that is going to persons with disability can be used to improve their welfare. That fund can be used for a lot of things. It can be used for scholarships for persons with disability. In some areas, they're using it very well, and you find that you go to a district and persons with disability are happy with the way things are going. In other places, the money is just shared amongst them and everybody goes and spends it, and that's the end of it. And so if this fund is used in a more judicious manner, it will improve the welfare of people. We're also encouraging employees not to create a barrier to employment because a person is disabled. Disability does not mean inability. Disability, I mean, I've worked with a minister who is visually impaired. I appointed him, and there were even some prejudices, old cultural prejudices. They said some chiefs were not supposed to see a blind person or shake a blind person. And I said, well, that's the minister I have. And that is your ministry. If you can't see a blind person, then it's your problem. you know, and he's worked. He's done his work as efficiently as any person. He's in cabinet. We make sure he has everything he needs to perform his duty as a minister in cabinet. And he's performed as well as any of my other cabinet ministers. Aside from that, we're actioning the Disability Act. In most of the public buildings now, we are ensuring that we're putting in ramps and other places to make the buildings accessible. Indeed, we've come out with the codes guiding all entities that are establishing public buildings on how to ensure that their buildings are disability friendly. And so those regulations have come out, and they're going to guide how public buildings are built into the future. The difficulty.
So that's the president speaking yesterday at the Evening Encounter. That was just before he left for the Upper West Region today on campaign business. Jennifer, so we're done with the president and his work and what he's up to. Mm-hmm. How about the MPP's presidential candidate, Nana Akufo-Addo? You were mentioning earlier that he is in the Eastern Region. Yes. What's up with him?
Well, he's gone, as we say, he's gone home. You know, this is his final trip to the Eastern Region before, you know, the elections, according to his itinerary. And right now he's touring a couple of areas, Donko Krum, Afram Plains as well. He's been speaking to the chiefs and people, trying to galvanize the electorate over there to remember him, you know, to help him unlock the door of Ghana in this year's general polls. But he's also promised, interestingly, a college of education at Donko Krum for, you know, potential teachers. And that's also stirring up quite a lot of interest over there.
Okay, we'll hear from him and directly tell us why that is important in that region. But let's briefly speak to Maxwell Kudeko, our man following the MPP's presidential candidate as we speak. Max, good afternoon to you. Where is Nana Akufo-Addo and what is he up to? Maxwell, can you hear me? Good afternoon. Maxwell, can you hear me? Good afternoon. Okay, it seems that he's in the thick of campaign business. Quite a lot of noise in the background I can hear. We'll restore contact with him in just a moment. But Jennifer, you were speaking of the Donko Krum promise that Nana Akufo-Addo made. Mm-hmm. What exactly is he promising and why is it important?
Well, it's important for that area and also for that region because they've seen the deficit of, you know, areas of education for people who aspire to be teachers.
Okay. So Jennifer, let me stop you just for 1 minute. Let's speak to Max. I'm just hoping that he can hear us now with all the noise. Max, good afternoon to you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, Pastor, it's the first time before.
Great. I can tell you're shouting because of the background activity. Tell us where Nana is now and what he's up to.
That's right. Nana is presently at the Suhum Park in the Suhum constituency. Thousands of party sympathizers in the Suhum constituency have gathered here to listen to him. Earlier this afternoon, we went to the Pantiapasa constituency and the Rebuafa North constituency. Yesterday, Nana was at the Afram Place North and North constituency, where he promised the people to construct a bridge on the Afram River to link the Kwau and the Afram Plains constituencies of this region to enhance easy transport of farm produce from the Afram Plains North and South constituency to the rest of the part of the country. Francis, I must say that the crowd we have seen at the Sum constituency is the largest crowd we have throughout the tour of Nana Akufo-Addo in the Eastern Region in his last phase. Throughout his speech, Nana has been assuring the people of his commitment to build a better and a prosperous Ghana. He has been talking about his vision on education, agriculture, job creation, and then also to also create a corruption-free environment. Nana has been talking about what he intends to do for the aged who did not have formal education, and then also for those who are yet to acquire education. Presently, we are at the Suhum constituency, where score of party followers or party sympathizers and bigwigs, including a member of parliament for Abuakwa South constituency, Honorable Atakia, the MP for Abitiki is also here, together with other party wings. Nana is yet to speak at the Suhum constituency. But also, as I indicated earlier, he has been talking about the free SHS, which says that he's going to ensure that it happens. And then also, he's been talking about how he's going to revolutionize agriculture and
in
job
the
part,
okay, that's
in
fine.
The country.
All right. Thank you, Max Okudeko. Clearly, he's been a busy man in his home region. We'll get some more updates for you here on this channel later on. But that's for Nana Akufo-Addo and the MPP as the heat is on, 19 days to go to the elections. So MPP, NDC, we know where they are, what they're up to.
True.
What about the Convincing People's Party? Ivor Kobnagin Street.
Yes. Now, remember when the president mentioned that he's going to pay special attention to people with disabilities?
Yes.
During that excerpt that we watched. Well, that's also the focus point of what the CPP presidential candidate is also promising the people of the northern region as he tours. He's promised to make healthcare, education, and public transport progressively free for people with disabilities. And he said that during a rally of supporters at Saboba in that region.
Let's hear from him now.
Education for persons with disabilities will be totally free from kindergarten all the way to tertiary. That healthcare for persons with disabilities and access to the NHIS will be totally free. We will ensure that even transportation will be made progressively free for all persons with disabilities. That our potential for the District Assembly Common Fund for persons with disabilities will go straight immediately to 5%. Apart from that, that money will not go to the District Assembly, but will be directly into a separate bank account and a separate fund to be used for that purpose. And then on top of that, we shall be passing a law which shall require all employers, whether in the private sector or in the public sector, to employ at least 5% of their workforce as persons with disabilities.
That's the CPP's Ivor Kobnagin Street promising some free things for persons with disabilities, education, healthcare, and also transportation for persons with disabilities across the country. It's the season of promises in politics in Ghana. From the CPP, let's now move to the PNC. Yes, clearly Nkrumah is parties there. Dr. Edward Mahama, where is he?
And over the weekend, they launched their manifesto.
Well, that's actually 2 days ago.
Yes, that's
actually yesterday.
That's actually yesterday.
Yeah.
And it's called Never Fear, Never Force, you know, something along those lines. But it's very strongly emphasizing on how they're going to fight against corruption. And that was in Bolgatanga. And the presidential candidate has also emphasized how they're going to use, if they're voted into power, how they're going to do what they can to close all the loopholes where corruption tends to seep in.
Mm-hmm. Is he still in Bolgatanga?
No, he's not. At the moment, he's back in Accra, and he's planning a rally actually tomorrow at Nima and Mamobi, so we expect fireworks there as well.
Okay, so it's looking like every region you touch, there's a candidate in there doing something. Mm. What about the NDP, National Democratic Party, Nana Akunedo Ajimangrole? Where is she?
You know, she tried to slip under the radar, but not quite. She's just ended her campaign tour of the Volta region. And that's very interesting. When you remember the way the presidential ballot paper is arranged, the NDP is directly above the NDC, if we remember, yes. So there was a couple of questions about, oh, well, maybe people get confused about the order or whatnot. So we'll see how that pans out from December 7th. But the thing is, she was there, she's campaigned, and she's moving back to the Greater Accra to also start her campaign tour here.
Okay, and we learned that for Nana Akunedo Ajimangrole, she's heading to the Eastern region when she returns to Accra from the Volta region. We'll see how that plays out. And it's looking as though, for every swing region and where the votes are tilted in one direction, there's an effort by the other candidates to try and chip the votes of the other party strongholds in that regard. But let's hear from Dr. Edward Mahama of the PNC, speaking at the manifesto launch, touching on the major issues which he feels should be germane on the minds of people for you to vote for him in this year's elections.
The economy of Ghana, the economy is in serious trouble. Why? Because we are borrowing more than we are earning. And therefore, we are incurring a debt for your children and your children's children. That is unfair, very, very unfair, that we should chop the money and ask them to pay for it. So I'm coming, as my running mate said, to make sure that we have a balanced budget, to make sure that we grow the economy of Ghana at 10% per annum on the back of agri only. Dr. Kwame Nkrumah brought us independence, set Mahama is going to bring economic independence to Ghana and Africa. Those of you who are religious and know a little bit about God, you know that in 6 days, God created everything that he created.
Yes.
On the seventh day, he rested.
So I have
been put on number six as a sign of completion. God completed creating everything he created on the sixth day. I have the number six. That is the end of your problems in Ghana. Yeah.
So that's the PNC's presidential candidate, Dr. Edward Mahama, speaking there in Bogotanga. We know he's back. He's heading to another region to continue with his campaign. Let's bring you an update. And we've tried to get you as much information as we can on all the candidates who are busy on the ballot paper, seven of them. The last one is Jacob Oseyemwa. Yes.
How could you forget?
He says his name represents perfection. Number seven, perfection.
Mm-hmm.
What is he perfecting right now with his campaign?
Well, at the moment, he's also doing, you know, he's also tried to do the undercover campaigning, but not quite because we caught him. At the moment, he's been talking to various religious groups as well, and he's due to meet the TUC tomorrow before he embarks or starts on his national campaign in the Eastern region.
Okay.
Shortly after that.
All right. Thank you, Jennifer. That'll be a wrap on the campaigns for all the candidates, presidential candidates, who are contesting for your votes come December 7th. They are crisscrossing the country, entering every nook and cranny, trying to convince you to vote for them. We've brought you the details. It's your choice to decide who to vote for.